By the grace of Christ, my brethren, we will continue our lesson from the Gospel according to John. The Gospel according to John, chapter 5, and verse 12. John 5, 12, by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Then they asked him, "Who is the man who said to you, 'Take up your bed and walk'?" But the one who was healed did not know who it was. For Jesus had withdrawn, a multitude being in that place. Afterward, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, "See, you have been made well. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you." The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had made him well. For this reason, the Jews persecuted Jesus and sought to kill him, because he had done these things on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them, "My Father has been working until now, and I have been working." Therefore the Jews sought all the more to kill him, because he not only broke the Sabbath, but also said that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Then Jesus answered and said to them, "Most assuredly I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he sees the Father do, for whatever he does, the Son also does in like manner. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all things that he himself does, and he will show him greater works than these, that you may wonder, marvel. For as the Father raises the dead and gives life to them, even so the Son gives life to whom he will. For the Father judges no one, but has committed all judgment to the Son, that all should honor the Son just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life, and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. Most assuredly, I say to you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted to the Son to have life in himself, and has given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Do not marvel at this, for an hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth, those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. I can of myself do nothing. As I hear, I judge. And my judgment is righteous, because I do not seek my own will, but the will of the Father who sent me. If I bear witness of myself, my witness is not true. There is another who bears witness of me, and I know that the witness which he witnesses of me is true. You have sent to John, and he has borne witness to the truth. Yet I did not receive testimony from man, but I say these things that you may be saved. He was the burning bush and shining lamp, and you were willing for a time to rejoice in his light. But I have a greater witness than John's. For the works which the Father has given me to finish, the very works that I do, bear witness of me that the Father has sent me. And the Father himself who sent me has testified of me. You have neither heard his voice at any time, nor seen his form. But you do not have his word abiding in you, because whom he sent, him you do not believe. You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and they are which testify of me. But you are not willing to come to me, that you may have life. I do not receive honor from men, but I know you, that you do not have the love of God in you. I have come in my Father's name, and you did not receive me. If another comes in his own name, him you will receive. How can you believe, who rejoice, receive honor from one another, and do not seek the honor that comes from the only God? Do not think that I shall accuse you to the Father. There is one who accuses you, Moses, in whom you trust. For if you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe my words? Amen. And It is a great truth, my brethren, that if we do not believe in the written words of the Old Testament, it is impossible for us to believe in the words of Christ. And it is a fact, it is written, and the Bible cannot be cancelled, that the fathers of the Israelites are our fathers as well. The father of faith, Abraham, who stood in the presence of God and won over for himself and for his seed and for all of humanity, this great promise that applies to every man who receives the Word of God and submits to the Word of God. This man enjoys the promise that God gave to Abraham when he told him, in blessing I will bless you, in multiplying I will multiply your descendants as the stars in heaven and the sand on the shore of the sea. So it is a necessary condition for us to receive the whole Word of God as a divinely inspired scripture, which it is. And that means that it is written by one author, and this author is no one else than God Himself. That is, we will never cease thinking that the holy letters, the Old Testament as well as the New Testament, have been written for the salvation of mankind. The Old Testament, specifically the Old Testament, for doctrine and training. And especially the New Testament with the words of Christ, which are spirit and life, that give life, regeneration, and salvation, the rapture of the church to man. So think now that the people of Israel had the Old Testament in their hand, which was necessary for them to believe in that, so that they may accept Jesus Christ alive in their life. And they had the Old Testament, and they believed in the Old Testament. And they did not accept Christ. They did not accept Christ, and the reason is simple and clear. Why? Because their heart was not clean. Only whoever has a clean heart, a pure heart, can see God in their life. But their heart was not pure because they claimed, through the Word of God, glory one from one to the other. What they cared about, therefore, was not the mysteries of God, the written Word of God, but they cared that through the Word of God, instead of them giving glory to God, that they may receive glory from one another and give glory to one another. What's the result that the Bible says here? How are you able to believe in my words? Christ says this. You who receive honor from one another, where you ought to be seeking the honor that comes from the only God. So if man who comes into the church, even if he believes in the Old Testament, even if he has accepted Christ in his life, if he expects the other people to honor him, and he cares about himself honoring other people as well, that is, one to receive glory and honor from another and to give, then it is not possible for him to believe in Christ, to receive Christ, and his life to depend on God's activities through Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. That is, my beloved brethren, it's extremely important when we come into the church to have cleared up in our heart why we come. Why do we come? What is that we want when we come into the church? It's like those who are intending to get married. They say, I'll get married. So they can be sure that God will bless one and the other separately, but both together. They have to have realized deep within their heart why they are getting married. What is their motive? And what are they trying to do with this? If their motive is eternal life and salvation for the husband, through the family, through his family to serve Christ, and to have good fruit, so that God may bless him by creating conditions so that he may serve his wife and make her happy, then that is a good sign and it will have a future. But if the woman does not realize that through this marriage, salvation will be in her soul through childbearing, thus becoming a housekeeper, which means that she has her household in her own hand, so that she may serve her husband and children. And this is the work of God that is for her. Then she got married in vain, one and the other as well. If they haven't realized the purpose of their life, they got married in vain. It's for nothing. But especially, my beloved brethren, they expected the blessing of God for nothing. The same thing goes for the church. We come to the church not so they can serve us, not so we can request from God to fulfill our petitions, but we come to church so that God may act in salvation in our life, and so that we may serve our brethren. And even more with works that has labor, and love that has sacrifice. Otherwise, we come to church for nothing. That is, when I come into the church and look around to see from whom I will win, will gain, what man will help me, then vanity of vanities, all things are vanity in my life. When a person gets married and he expects his wife to do everything for him and to give everything in his hand, vanity of vanities, all things are vanity. But also the woman, when she gets married and she says, I am not the housekeeper, I will not cook, I will not prepare this, I will not take care of my household and children, I do not want to have children. Vanity of vanities, that all things are vanity. There will be no results in their life. And what happens then? They enter the category of Esau, who care about the present time only. And they exit the category of Jacob, who cares about eternal things. And this is not a simple thing. It's not simple. Imagine a young girl, my brethren, who has a young man standing in front of her, who is strong, he is able, he is very capable in hunting, at work. And a young man over there, who is weak, who is cooking with his wife, with his mother. Whom will she choose? Who must she choose? Who would you choose? That is how our whole life is, my brethren. What do you choose in your life? He says, you ask and do not receive because you ask amiss. You ask so you can fulfill your passions, your desires. Whom will you choose? The strong lad Esau, or young man Jacob? The well-being and pleasure of this world, or sacrifice and labor? The choices that we are called to make are extremely serious. For that reason, our Lord says two things. Judge the righteous judgment. Do not judge according to the appearance, according to the flesh, but judge the righteous judgment. As my judgment is righteous, and why is it righteous? Because I do not seek my own will, but the will of the Father who sent me. So how will our judgment be righteous? If we seek Christ's will in our life. But if we place our will before everything, why should I cook for my husband? Leave him alone. He'll find some food to eat. That isn't righteous judgment. Why should I help my wife? Leave her. Let her be. She'll manage on her own. That is not righteous judgment. Why should I labor in the work of God? Isn't it better for me to just quiet down, relax, and enjoy the blessings of God in my life? That isn't righteous judgment. Why should I force myself to sacrifice, to make sacrifices of love? I can stand from afar. That isn't righteous judgment. It's a result that God's reward does not come. For that reason, the characteristic example of the men who wanted their own things, Esau, was the Pharisees, the scribes, the chief priests. Why do you walk on a Sabbath day and you lift your bed on your back on a Sabbath day? And he who was healed said, he who healed me told me to do this. Who is this man who told you to do this? He said, I don't know. He healed me and he left. Christ left, but his work did not come to an end. And his work isn't only healing. His work is salvation. It isn't for him to help you and to bless you. It's for him to save you and to preserve your salvation. So he approaches him and tells him, come here now. Were you saved? Were you healed? Of course I was healed. Be careful, he tells him. The cause of this sickness that you had was sin. From here on, be careful. Do not commit the same sin so that a worse sickness won't come upon you. If Christ hadn't told them these words, the work of Christ would have been half in his life, because as in the beginning he got sick because he sinned, so also the second and third time he could sin again and suffer worse things. But when the healed man learned who Jesus Christ was, he went to the scribes and Pharisees immediately, because they asked him who he was, not to give him in, I dare say out of joy. He went and told them that Jesus is he who healed me. And instead of them, the men, to rejoice or to be amazed or to praise God as they ought to have because of the healing of this man who was 38 years old sick, instead of them looking at this benedicted man from Christ, because they did not seek the glory of God, but they sought glory one from the other, and because these people saw Jesus from Nazareth being glorified, they began to persecute him because they could not take it that God may bless someone else, that God may glorify someone else from among them. They couldn't accept it. They could not accept the blessing of God upon others except through them. Only to them. So they began to persecute him. And our Lord answered them and said, what does it seem strange to you? My Father works until now, and I have been working. What you see now is the work of my Father and my work. And my Father is working, and the work of the Father is for them to believe in the one that he sent. And I am working in preserving life and the ones that God sends me, the Father sends me. This is a work, therefore, which is glorious. That in the spiritual work, the Father works through Jesus Christ, and the spiritual life, that it couldn't even pass their mind, the mind of the scribes and Pharisees, what this meant. But it is so true. The Father draws, with his love, people to himself, so that he may convince them and send them to Christ so that they may believe in him. That is the work of the Father. He tells them, go to him. And the work of Christ, the one that you have given me, Father, to save, and I want to take them to heaven, that's his work. With the result, the glory that God had is transferred to Christ now. The glory that Christ enjoyed is transferred from him to the Father. That is the work of God. Even Christ did not hold on to the glory that his Father gave him, but the Father as well. He did not hold for himself the glory that he had from the beginning. And if God, through Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, transfers glory from one to the other, how much more than we men? Man who claims, who wants glory for himself, this man does not enjoy the blessing of God. Remember Saul, who was so grieved when he transgressed, not because he broke the word of God, but because he believed that Samuel would not honor him before the people. And though Samuel rebuked him, and he told him, what is this that you've done? You broke the word of God, transgressed the word of God. Do you not understand that you lose everything? By violating the word of God, do you not realize that you will lose everything? And I'll say it more simply now. My brother, by breaking the word of God, by violating it, do you not understand? Do you not realize that you lose everything? Don't you believe it? My sister, by transgressing the word of God, do you not understand that you may lose everything? When God showed a dream to Nebuchadnezzar, that out of his pride, he would be persecuted by men. He heard it, but he did not take it into account. And how could he take it into account? Since he was the ruler of the world, he was the sovereign power then. Who can drive me away? Who? Not a man, but God. And Daniel advised him and told him, correct your ways. Correct your transgressions and iniquities. Humble yourself. But he did not heed his words. And within 1 year, people cast him out. Whom? The Almighty One. Why? Because he lost it. Daniel, when the king told him this revelation from God, how people would drive him out from being king and emperor, but he told him that God revealed to him that he would cast him out, and he did cast him out. Whatever we have at this moment from God is not granted. Never could the scribes and Pharisees imagine that God would take them out of his work, out of his plan. Never. The people of Israel were the center of God's attention, and they became the center of God's curse in the end. And Christ prophesied to them, the Bibles told them, the scriptures told them. But because they had absolute confidence, because of the blessings of God and on themselves, they did not give importance, they did not heed the word of God, they did not believe that the blessing of God has been broken, has been interrupted, if man does not take care. We've said simple things. Do not chew chewing gum in church. Do not chew it. No one takes it into account. They smile. Do you not understand that this isn't good in the eyes of God? Do you not understand that the grace of God will be taken? But you tell me now, because of chewing gum. This is a small example that I'm giving now. Every one of us knows his transgressions and iniquities. We know them. But we have to be careful. God suffers long. God waits for us to repent. How many times did he not say to the scribes and Pharisees, how many times I wanted to gather you under my wings like the hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you did not want it. Man doesn't want. Why don't you want? Why do you not want the blessing of God to be multiplied in your life? You want to find yourself in danger? Our soul is continuously in danger, my brethren. Don't you want to take care of your husband? Don't you understand that your soul is in danger if you do that? Don't you want to take care of your wife? Do you not understand that your life is in danger when you do that? Do you not want to serve in the work of God? Which work of God is for us to believe in Jesus Christ, the Word of God, because our soul is in danger? And because he spoke about his father, the scribes and Pharisees persecuted him even more because he made himself Son of God. But we thank God because God never ceased loving them. He continued loving them. And he encouraged them and advised them, us as well. He never ceased. Because he wants the best for man. He wants the good thing for man. He has good counsels for man. He doesn't want the grief of man. He wants man to have joy, the child of God to have joy. And so he reveals to this man who persecuted him and mocked him and did not take the word of God into account, who laughed, who enjoyed themselves, who have lost their sense of direction and they do not know why they're here today. Why have we come here? Why do we approach Christ? And he says, the Son cannot do anything on his own. You saw that I healed that man. You saw that I told him to lift his bed on the Sabbath and to do it. I did it, but I did not do it on my own. And I did not do it because I cannot do things on my own. That is what the man of God is. That is who he is. Not only do I not want to do anything on my own, but I cannot. Something does not permit me to do things that are outside the will of my Father. What is this that doesn't permit me? The rebuke of the Holy Spirit. The love that I have for God the Father. My devotion to Him. My desire to do His will does not permit me. I just can't. Even more. I cannot do anything if my Father doesn't do it. Because whatever He does, in the same way, in a similar way, the Son does. So that is, Jesus Christ becomes an imitator of God. And what does the Apostle Paul say? Imitate me as I imitate Christ. So, behold a pattern that the Word of God brings before us. It isn't for me to imitate you and you to imitate me. And me to honor you and you to honor me. Because a blind man will lead a blind person and they will both fall into a sewer. But all of us, whoever of us are here today, we must see one person. We must hope in one person. We must expect everything from one person. And we want to be like one person. That is Jesus Christ. Only Him. Only Him. All other persons in the church are in the church so that we may serve them. But we will give glory to one alone. We will listen to one alone. We will submit and obey to one alone. Hope in one alone and glorify one alone. Because we know that not even an inch of glory belongs to us. Nothing. And when I say to us, and to you, and to you, and to me, neither do I expect for you to honor me, neither must you expect me to honor you. Neither do I want to glorify you, neither must you want to glorify anyone else. But one person is the center of the attention of the church. That is the person that is called Jesus Christ. From Him we expect everything. In Him we hope. And He says, the Father can give life to the dead. And He has given authority to the Son as well to give life to the dead. But He also gave, the Father gave judgment to the Son. Now, look at this separation of authorities, this outpouring of authorities. The Father gives authority so that he may have life and give life. And he gives him authority to judge so that people may see the Son having the authority of the Father, thus honoring and glorifying the Son. So it is not only that God wants Christ to be glorified among us, but he also helps us by pouring out all his authorities upon Jesus Christ. He says he wants and he has, and we have to give all glory to him. That's what the Church of Christ is. That is how it is. That is how the house of God is, where God dwells within us. And so we can say it more simply so that our small and insignificant little mind may understand it. When we say Son, which is a person, at the same time it's the Word of God. So my dear brethren, we have come here so we can meet the one that God has sent, Jesus Christ, God the Father. That is in reality. We have come to listen to the Word of God. And we pray that the word of man may be word of God when it comes out of the mouth of the preacher. And we accept in our heart the word of man as a word of God. And we pray that it may operate among the believers, that the word of God may have results. Because the word of God is truly alive and sharper than any two-edged sword. And it comes to the division of the soul and spirit, so that man may clear up with the word of God that the Father sends, and the things that he wants, to distinguish the things that he wants and the things that he has to do. Because there are the wills of man, the desires of man, but there are also the musts of God, which are the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is the first differentiation. The second differentiation is the things that I think that they are correct and the things that Christ, the Word of God, says are correct, so that we may decide. Because I may want something and I may know that it is not right. But at the same time, I may think that something is right while it is not. All these things, the Word of God comes in my heart, in our heart, and completes them, and that is why we come. The Word of God that is sent by the Father through Jesus Christ in the Holy Spirit is the one that clarifies things in the mind of man and puts everything in order so that man may understand, so that man may judge and compare, choose and reject, and in the end, to execute. So we come here for the Word of God. And now Jesus Christ says, most assuredly I say to you, he who hears my word, the reason for which you come here, and believes in him who sent me, then and only then do you have everlasting life. So man must first of all listen to the word of God carefully, must realize, judge and discern and comprehend and accept that this is a word of God, because it is in accordance with the written word of God by the Holy Spirit. And then he must believe that God sent this word. And then and only then does man have eternal life. Otherwise, he doesn't. If you do not hear the word of God and do not believe that this word was sent from the Father, then you cannot have eternal life. It is impossible for there to be eternal life. For that reason, most assuredly I say to you, says Christ, the hour is coming and now is when the dead will hear, the dead in this world, because of their sins and their transgressions, dead in their sins, they will hear the voice of the Son of God. When they hear this voice, Then, only whoever has heard this voice will live. If the word of God does not come into their life, and they do not accept the word of God as a word of God, that it is, then there is no life within them. They have the name that they are alive, but they are dead. And what does "they will hear and those who hear will live" mean? It means, may they hear. So this is why we came to church, why Christ came, why we do whatever we do in our life, what our motive is. Did we come because it's a Luna Park here? It's not. Did we come here because we have our company with us? No. Do we come here to have fun and enjoy ourselves? No. Do we come here to win the things that have to do with our life, our survival? No. Do we expect to benefit from one another? Do we expect to receive glory from one another? Woe to us if we do this when we come here. For one reason alone do we come to this place. Only one reason. So that Christ may speak to us. No other word. No other reason. Either he do that through the doctrine of the apostles, either through breaking of bread or prayers or fellowship with one another. We want the word of God to come from heaven into our life. We want to accept it carefully and to observe it and receive it in our hearts so that we may execute it, thus having life and abundance here on earth and eternal heritage in the kingdom of heaven. Whatever the Christian does, my brethren, he does it consciously. Our worship toward God is sensible. It's logical. It is absolutely logical. The gospel of Jesus Christ, the word of God, is mathematics. 1 + 1 will definitely equal 2. There's no way that it will equal 1.5 or 2.5. That's how the word of God is. Whoever believes in him shall not be put to shame. That's it. God resists the proud. That's it. He who hears the word of God and believes in him who sent him has eternal life. The time will come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and only those who hear it will live. Why? As the Father has life in himself, so also he has granted to Christ to have life in himself. So the word of God, Christ, the word of God, gives life. Because it is alive, he is alive. He will give you life, and that in abundance. He will change everything. He will change your heart, your mind, your logic, your life, your appearance. Nothing will be left the same. From a dead man, because of your sins and your iniquities, you will become alive because of the word of God. But the time will also come when whoever is found in the graves and the tombs, they will also hear the voice of God in the end. They will be raised up also. But it doesn't say those who hear, those who accept. Everyone will hear the voice of God at some moment. And those who have done good will rise up. And those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation, and the others to the resurrection of life. There is a resurrection here on this face of the earth. I accept the word of God and life is given to me then. Life in abundance and eternal heritage. But in the end, there will be a resurrection as well. There is the first and there is the second resurrection. Blessed is he who partakes in the first resurrection from now. Blessed are those who die in the name of the Lord. Now he will introduce himself. And this, he does this so we can know ourselves, so we can know how to introduce ourselves. Because God says the person who introduces himself is not approved, but the one that God introduces is approved. If I have witness, bear witness of myself, my witness is not true. All these people bear witness of themselves. And this is another characteristic that the Christian has to be careful of. Never let him say to himself or to others, they wronged me. I was good. I am very good. But what God wants us to say is, I am wretched and vile. There is nothing good that I can present to God. And this is the truth. That's the truth. What is this good thing that you have or that I have that we can stand before God and just show Him? And may God then in righteousness bless us because of our righteousness. There's nothing good. If we seek God's righteousness in our life, then we're lost. We seek the grace of God. By grace you have been saved through faith. And this is the gift of God for you. So that no one can boast. And how nicely now does Jesus Christ introduce himself? No. Not by saying, I, but by saying, look. Look around and see who is testifying for me. First of all, John, you went and asked John concerning me. And he bore witness. You did not accept his word and you did not believe in him. He bore witness concerning me. He said, I am the light of the world, he said. I am the bread of life, he said. He said that I am the Son of the living God. He said that I am the beginning and the end. He said that I am the Alpha and the Omega. And you did not listen to him. You did not accept him. Well done. You did not accept his witness. Doesn't matter. But let us go a bit further. Look at the works that I am doing. Not I, but God through me, God the Father. Because I, as man, can do nothing on my own. But my Father is the one who does everything for me and through me. So the Christian has, first of all, a good witness. He has a good testimony by all. First of all, by our wife or our husband. It can't be now that your husband is miserable with you and you're having fun and say, oh, everything is nice, life is cheery. Or your wife to be miserable and afflicted and you to say, oh, I'm good and handsome. No. We must have good testimony. Good testimony from our relatives, from the elders, from the Word of God Himself. Otherwise, he's not a Christian. And what does he is not a Christian mean? He's lost if this happens. Woe if this happens. He has a good testimony, witness, because he's careful. He keeps watch and prays so that he may have a good witness and enjoy the blessing of God, but also so that God may be able to bless him personally, family-wise. Who will marry a young girl whose witness is horrible? It's testimony. All day she speaks in church, she laughs around, chews chewing gum, she doesn't do anything, she's careless, reckless. How will God bless this girl? A young man, the same thing goes. How will God bless him? The same thing goes with a family. How will God bless a family that is that way? They do not take God into account. But Jesus Christ has a good testimony, first of all, by God, who is the sent messenger of God. He is the voice of the Holy Spirit. Secondly, with his works, God testifies that he is with him. And his works, lift up your bed and walk. Who did this? Did I, man, Christ Jesus, do this? No, my Father did it. The works that I do and testify concerning me are not mine, but my Father does them. So, he has the witness of God as well. The Christian has the witness of Christ. Not only of men, of believers. Unbelievers, we don't really care about what unbelievers say. Well, they won't say good things concerning us, of course. And we don't expect to hear good things. But the witness of the believers, of the church, of those who have the Holy Spirit, that is very important. But the most important thing of all is the witness of the men of God. Secondly, the witness of the work of God. The tree can tell a tree from its fruit. A bad tree cannot produce good fruit. A good tree cannot produce bad fruit. When a tree is good, it will definitely produce good fruit. But there is also a third one who testifies concerning God, concerning the Christian, God Himself. He will find a way. He said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." They never heard His voice. You never heard His voice, He said to the scribes and Pharisees. You couldn't hear His voice, and you couldn't see His face. But I have heard His voice, and He has introduced me. And my dear brethren, God has ways to introduce His people. He has ways. And we all know this. From the simplest thing, you see a man, and suddenly his face shines. You say, what happened with this man? What happened? His smile is warm. His eyes are warm. Immediately you say, Christ is introducing him to me. I remember there was a friend of mine who was very tough. We were very good friends in the world. But he had got in trouble with Hinduists. He came when I believed, and he came to scold me and to rebuke me and to tell me what a mistake I made. We worked together, and he was a very good man. Whenever he'd come into my office, he'd rebuke me and mock me. Not with evil, though. He said, come on, George, what has happened to you? We're speaking to me about Christ again. Come on, let's go for a walk. Let's go for a ride. Let's go have fun. His wife was also very harsh. So one day, he came in the office, I remember. As soon as he came in with an appetite to bug me and to trouble me, he opened the door, he came in, and he was stunned. He sat there for 1 or 2 minutes, and then he left. The next day, he told me, will we go to church together? I said, you, we'll go to church. He said, yes, let's go together to church. You know what happened, he told me? I said, no. Remember when I came in your office the other day? I said, yes. I came in, and there was this intense light in that office that blinded me. The whole office was full of light, and you were shining bright. And I could not stand, I could not speak, so I left. So, something is going on with you. Something's happening. He came, he was born again immediately. Soon after that, he was baptized in the Holy Spirit, and he glorifies God. And he was the one, I'll tell you, who in the previous church, we had a neighbor across the street who would always shout against us. He persecuted us. He shouted and shouted, made noise. He didn't let us park in front of the sidewalk. He'd even come to the point of scratching our cars. So one day, he went as well. He was an instructor of Taekwondo or Karate. He was a very hard man. So he parked in front of his car, his house, the other man's house. So the neighbor came and told him, get away from here. He took his car and drove it a bit back. The neighbor came out and said, get out of here, I told you. He humbled himself a bit more, so he drove a bit further back. A third time he came out and said, get out of here. So he told him, come here, come here. The neighbor came, and he was pretty... He said, from here forward, you will not park again. He told him, listen to me. I've not become like them yet. Don't speak to me again like that because I will smash your face in. I'm not like them yet, he said. He was new in Christ. He had conscience in himself. The neighbor never troubled us again after that. He went in his house and he never came out again. He said, they're not all the same. There are some who are still a bit rough. Glory be to God. But let us return. What matters, my dear brethren, is for the men of God to introduce us, Christ to introduce us with His works, and Christ to introduce us with His presence. And then, then we are also sure that God is with us, that we are going on well, and that the next day will be a day of blessing, of glory, and in that day, God will find us ready for the kingdom of heaven. Amen.